In this video, we're going to give you a close-up treatment of one of the parts of the V2 rocket that doesn't actually show up very well on the existent cine and still archive record. In fact, there are very few drawings around as well of this area of the rocket, and in particular, I'm talking about this little cat flap structure that we see here in the equipment bay area of the nose of the rocket. This is the part where the umbilical cables actually connected into the rocket so that the firing engineers could get a understanding of what was going on inside the rocket, the pressures, the start-up for the gyro, and to power the systems before it went over to its own onboard power systems. Now, we're going to conduct this close-up by looking at some relics. We're also going to look at one or two bits of archive footage and try to get a better understanding of actually what actually goes on in this region of the umbilical cable port on the V2 rocket. First up then, let's actually have a look at a genuine relic. This is actually one of the two plug components. Sorry, this is actually I'm calling this the plug because it conforms to the normal standards of a male plug. You can see we've got these components here, and I'm calling the cable part, the external cabling that goes onto this, the socket. So there are two of these plug systems in the equipment bay. This is how they were actually found. These were retrieved at Nordhausen in the metalwork factory facility, somewhere in the region of tunnel number 20. We can see the two plugs here with their associated cabling. And the one we're looking at here is actually this one that you can see in the bottom right-hand corner of your screen. Now, we've cleaned it up a lot, and the reason it looks wet or shiny is it's been treated with an acrylic material to stop it rotting. It had been partly submerged in water for some part in the last 70 years and is obviously in a pretty rough condition. Anyway, let's just show you the important parts of this. The most noticeable thing we've got is this stem in the center of the plug, and the details that I want you to see here, this is quite a substantial component, and we've got this step. Now, this step is a seating zone for a spring located in the socket. And if we look at the tooth right on the tip here, there would be a solenoid-driven electromechanical locking system in the socket that locked into that tooth. For orientation, we've got these empty ports here, which have no electrical connections at the back of them, so that probably helped key that together. This plate that you see at the foreground, incidentally, this has got 65 connections on here, but if you count up the cabling, there's only about 60 good connections actually going to this one. So it obviously had a few connections in hand from the version that we're looking at here. We've got two different cable types here. We've got this thinner single core material, and then also this much heavier, higher amperage single core material here at the back as well. This plate we see on the front here would appear to have been spring loaded. The springs at the front here appear to have rotted away, but there is one still in position over here on this corner, and an examination of that does show that to be a spring. So although at the back here the conductors are actually showing, this is probably what it was more like when you saw the new undamaged version of it, and this spring loading would have been part to help make the connection between this plug face and the socket. Another interesting thing to note is the way it's been mounted. This spring mechanism here is no part of the ejection system. This has actually been mounted on this crossbar to give it this. If I just put it down on the ground here, you can see it's got a very soft connection to make sure that everything marries up well and it doesn't get pulled or anything like that during any part of the setting up process, just to make sure that everything is self-seating and self-centering. It's mounted on that spring system. We can see we've got a very substantial cable tie here to support the cabling on this tongue, and it would appear that this tongue has at some point in its history broken away from its mooring just at the bottom here. That's obviously just broken away. So the way to picture this working is probably pointing down at roughly this angle in the equipment bay behind the spring-loaded flap that we showed you earlier. the socket position literally going on to this spring-loaded spine. There would be two of these. Remember, the other one would be next to it here. And at the appointed time, after engine fire, the electromagnetic catches would release, the spring would drive the socket away from this face with the additional spring tensioning of this place here, and then gravity and an appropriate loading of the boom that was carrying the cables would allow these to simply fall away under the influence of gravity. The spring-loaded cat flap or door would latch down actually behind it, and the rocket would actually be on its way. Now that we know what we're looking for, let's take a quick look at the presentation of the umbilical hardware as found in some of the photographic evidence. This rare colour photograph shows Dora labour camp prisoners working at equipment test rigs in the Nordhausen tunnels in central Germany where the V2 was manufactured. The man on the left appears to be testing relay switches. This photograph only hints at the grim, dehumanising conditions experienced by prisoners at the Dora labour camp as a whole. Both test rigs have the umbilical plug assemblies fitted. They were called Stotzstecker, or the Stotz plug. Stotz was the name of the manufacturer. This photo was taken during Operation Backfire in Cuxhaven. We're looking at the equipment bay section of the V2, showing bay sector number 2 with the panel removed. The inspection door to section number 3 is open. It can be seen on the extreme right of your picture. The large domed cover at the bottom of the long silver air breather pipe in this section is covering one of the guidance control gyroscopes. In case you were wondering, that honeycomb-shaped mesh you can see in the floor of the equipment bay is indeed chicken wire. Aerospace-grade chicken wire, of course. At least that's what it said on the contractor's invoice. All the best rockets have it. The umbilical plug assemblies can be seen in the centre of your picture. Note that the brass conductors are hidden from view by those spring-loaded fibreboard faceplates. Also, note the angle of the locking stems pointing down at about 45 degrees. We can see the plug assemblies and the stems clearly in this classic picture showing American soldiers examining an incomplete rocket found in a railway siding. They appear to be measuring the length of number 2 equipment bay. That chicken wire is clamouring to be noticed again. I've come to the Luftwaffe Museum in the Gittau district of Berlin, Germany. I'm here to look at one of their exhibits that will give us a bit more understanding of the function and character of the V2's umbilical cable system. As you can see, the exhibit comprises the 4-compartment equipment bay section of the rocket with the warhead and nose cone attached. The warhead and body shell is empty apart from the plywood divider walls separating the equipment bays. Okay, so now we're getting a close-up view of the umbilical aperture itself. You can see that the hinge hangers are still in place on this relic. And we can see that the doorstop around the edge of the aperture is in position as well. The size of the aperture is around about 9 inches high by about 15 inches wide. This image of a door flap, the actual hatch flap itself, is from a UK exhibit, a rather rough UK exhibit in fact. Now we're just going to use a little bit of video magic here just to put the umbilical plugs in place, so you can see their attitude relative to the aperture here. This unusual image of a rocket in a loading yard affords us a good view of the umbilical hatch region of the equipment bay section without the hatch in position. And you can clearly see there that the socket support rods are very distinctive and easy to see in this picture. This is a picture showing a rocket being recovered by the Allies immediately after the war. And the hatch there appears to be getting a bit of abuse with the loading ropes. Probably not a good idea. This picture shows a rocket in preparation for a launch at Cuxhaven during Operation Backfire, and you can really see the size of the sockets on the cable there. Let's take a look at the umbilical cable system as a whole in action as it appears on the 16mm cinefilm archive. This launch is being played back at half normal speed, and you can see sockets 1 and 2 there swinging away freely. Let's just play that to you again. There they go, both plugs 1 and 2 swinging away. Now, I think it's actually quite difficult to see what's going on in the hatch region. So let's zoom in and give you some multiple action replays of this so you can actually see what's going on. We're going to play it forward and then in reverse so you can see the hatch opening. Forward again, back in reverse. And reverse again. Now very slow. You can see the hatch closing immediately after the sockets begin their fall. Okay, this is the launch of an A4B. Keep your eye on the rocket initially, and then the insert. Let's just show you that again for the detail. First of all, the rocket, then the insert. About 2 seconds elapses after the fall away of the sockets, just time enough for an observing engineer to bark out, "Stecker einen zwei gefallen." And finally, here's how bad things can go if a fault develops somewhere between the launch sequence timer and the umbilical cable release solenoids. Look at that curving loop of cable in the top left. It rises with the rocket, and look, the terminal sockets are missing. They've been ripped off the cable and are still stuck on the equipment bay plugs. No prizes for guessing how this thriller ends. Bye for now.